My biggest competition definitely going to be the greatest ghost chips.
Ghost chips versus Waza. And you best believe these guys, they know they stuff.
I don't know, I should feel nervous. I should be shaking, but I'm not at the moment.
I'm walking into this thinking that I should have this.
The young blood versus the old blood, so... Here we go, game number one, top 16, guys! I think Waza might be in a world of hurt right now. But Ghostship is playing very patient, very good.
You can see so much fear in the way Waza's playing.
Not enough against the counter hit!
Oh!
No, it's Waza!
He knows he didn't want to charge there.
He just made a fatal mistake right there, missing up the combo on the last minute.
Okay, so unfortunately, your man's got knocked out. Obviously, I'm pretty gutted, you know, but I've mentioned it before, it's... You only have yourself to blame, you know? Let's take it back to the lab, practice some more, and just think about the mistakes that you made, yeah. Shout out to the Standing Fierce crew, of course, and shout out to my family as well, you know, hashtag family man. That's how we do it.
Well, hello again, everyone. And this time we're back with one of the great legends. We all know him, we all love him. It is Waza. How are you, dude?
What's up? What's happening, Fano?
Yeah, man. Not much. Yeah, just the usual. Just give us a brief rundown about yourself.
Yeah, man, all good. So I've always gone by the gamertag Waza, you know, family man, few kids, wife, you know, good friend of everyone in the NZFGC. Been involved with them for a while, but, you know, here we are.
Yeah.
Stuck in isolation.
I know. Trying to make the most of it, eh? Getting paid while
always. Can't argue with that.
Yeah, man. So to start off with, what was your knowledge of fighting games before discovering the NZFGC?
Okay, so yeah, that's a fairly easy question for me. So before I started playing Street Fighter, Street Fighter got me involved with the NZFGC, but I was primarily a Tekken player. So while playing Tekken, I used to just go through feel and all that sort of thing. So all of this talk of frames and, you know, the like, I wasn't really using it. So yeah, as I moved into the NZFGC, I started getting more serious and talking about frame advantage and all of that sort of thing. So I'd probably say my knowledge was a bit lacking before I got involved, but yeah, that pretty much sums it up.
Okay. Well, so how did you come into the scene? Who kind of unveiled the mystery for you of the fighting game?
Okay. Yeah, so that would be my good friend, Simon Myover. He goes by the name of Rumble. He introduced me to all the competitions with New Zealand and what used to be called NZ-ism first, before it became Standing Fist. So, he brought me to the first Ranbats. I actually can't remember what year, but I think it was, this is going back. I can't even remember what the Cyber Cafe was called. Some of the other guys will be able to point you out what it was called. He brought me to a Rambats one day, and I just got hooked straight away. So, yeah, that's where it all began.
And Rumble, forgive me if I'm wrong, but he was quite a really strong player. Ghost Chip said that he was quite formidable in the Street Fighter 4 era. He said that he was kind of on top just before he pulled out Street Fighter 5, eh?
Yeah, so the last time me and Rumble played, that was actually the last competitive tournament that he attended, and he ended up beating me, the bastard.
Oh.
But, yes, so it was forever and ever, hold that L. I mean, it happens.
Yeah. So, like, when I think of you in the scene, I always, you know, it's you and Blackout, you know, you always had, like, you were the two Urians. How would you dabbled with Nekalian a bit, but how would you describe your playstyles in contrast?
I probably call my playstyle more of a... he's probably going to laugh at this, but mine's more sort of... I'll call it organized chaos.
Organized chaos.
Organized chaos. I like to do a lot... I like what would look like a lot of random stuff. Someone else will call me out and say, bro, that is random. But yeah, I like to do sort of random stuff and keep the screen busy. But yeah, Blackout, I would say, is more sort of fixed on certain styles and, you know, certain gameplay. That's what he sticks to. And
yeah,
that's what I'd say.
Have you had many run-ins with him in brackets for Street Fighter or any other games?
Street Fighter, the last time I played him in Street Fighter would have been a while ago. I think it was Red Zone Rumble 2.
Yeah.
And from memory, I was using Nakali and he was using Urien. And it was I think it was maybe the last round, last set sort of thing. And he ended up beating me. But apart from that, haven't really run into him in many other games.
Okay.
Mainly because he's so busy getting top two, top one. You know how it is.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I look at a character like Urien and he's got like these moves like Violent Knee, Chariot Tackle, Aegis. Mm. Like he just seems like a real angry character. Has anyone ever made you that angry ever?
That angry? Besides my kids? No. I can't say that I've been that angry. I'd imagine Nakali, he sort of mirrors that sort of personality as well, but yeah. No, I can't say that I have.
So, as a player, who are or who were your bad matchups?
Which era are we talking? Street Fighter V?
Street Fighter V.
Street Fighter V? Oh, yeah, that's an easy one. Probably be Sky.
Okay.
Yep, Sky's definitely up there. I don't remember the last time I've been them in a set. Maybe season one somewhere down the track, but yeah, Sky definitely. You've got players like Zazob and of course our champ, old Ghost Chips. But apart from that, I've been sort of up and down with playing everybody else, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes I have good days, sometimes bad days, but if I ever ran into those dudes, it was most of the time it was good night. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I did mention Blackout, and like him, you as well play multiple fighting games, and you are very skilled. Mm-hmm. So how do you distribute your time? No, of course. Well, how do you distribute your time between the titles?
For me, it was mainly, I get bored sort of sticking to one game all the time. So I sort of, if I got bored of it, I'll jump to a bit of Marvel or, you know, jump to a bit of Dragon Ball Z, which has been the game I've been playing lately.
Yeah.
But in terms of splitting time, it just depends who was on at the moment, you know, who was online, and if they won the games, I'd give them games.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's sort of what I followed.
So you did say Marvel. I think that mm-hmm. I love watching Marvel, but there's a certain hype to it that I don't think non-Marvel Capcom players really understand. Like
right.
Yeah, like. What's it about playing a game like Marvel? And you've got Dave, who's such a big fan, who hosts like the House of MC.
Yeah.
Like, how do you play a game where there's like literally so much happening on every edge of the screen?
Yeah, it's going on, right?
Yeah.
I can't remember which era it was that I first started watching Marvel and not understanding it. It might have been 2013, 14, somewhere thereabouts. But I remember all the guys in the NZFGC just saying, oh, Marvel's hype and all this sort of buzz. And I was like, oh, you're all right. I'll sort of invest myself into it and watch maybe the top 32. And like some of the other people, when you don't know what's going on, you don't sort of understand. It's hard to get, you know, sucked into it without, you know, the obvious things of long combos and infinites and all that sort of thing. So I guess after that, yeah, I decided, all right, I'll pick it up and started practicing it a little bit more. And ended up getting Seb or Linux to teach me how to play it. So, yeah, that's where my love for Marvel came from.
He's definitely the teacher you want to have. Like,
yeah, man. He is ruthless.
He just infuses every bit of learning with energy. And it's like,
yep.
It's inspiring, but then it's also scary at the same time because it's like, do you ever come down, man? It's like, or are you always so hyped?
Wow. No, he has his moments, but those are usually off camera, you know. He was a really good teacher, man. Like, he didn't give me no sort of chance to do stuff. It was he'd teach me some sort of principle, and then it was up to me to land it. You know, he'd never give me the chance to actually do it. You know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was great.
So, how do you find Ultimate Marvel? Are you an Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom fan, or did you ever you dabbled a bit at Infinite, but in terms of your liking, what was your view on the two games?
Oh, okay. So, with Ultimate Marvel, you know, all of the Marvel players are going to talk about it. You know, it's Transitioning from 3 to Infinite was actually quite difficult for me. I just couldn't get the hang of it, you know. I did understand the mechanics and all that sort of thing, but I mean, I guess some of the anti-hype that came with Infinite may have had a hand in it, but I couldn't get into the game, you know. I just wasn't enjoying it as much as Marvel 3. Sort of hard to explain, but you know, the hype elements are they're different, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, I was just playing it for the sake of playing it, you know.
Yeah. Well, you are a father in the FGC, and I mean, you're not the only one. There's also like Kyoki and Milkshake Duck, who plays Falk in Street Fighter. And I really admire how you get your kids to respect not just what you do, but just fighting, like just people who game in general. So what was it like trying to explain or show them that this is what Daddy does? You know, he plays games to, you know, a certain level where it's not just a hobby, it's a lifestyle.
Yeah, I'm not too sure. It was mainly because, you know, the kids will always just default to being a spectator and watching Dad and looking at this controller that no one else has and explaining what it is kind of thing.
Yeah.
But, from time to time, the kids will want to jump on and have a go of it and see what they can do. And, you know, they have a lot of fun with it. And I guess trying to explain it would be a bit difficult because, you know, without getting too technical, you know, you just say, oh, you just got to beat them up, you know. You beat them up, you win.
Yeah.
That was the basis of it. So
you got...
They understand it.
Yeah. So you got 3 kids, am I right? Because I thought you had 2, but have you had a newborn?
So I've got my son who's, he just turned 10. My daughter, she's 5 now. She'll be 6 this year. And also my little girl, she's just turned 1.
Oh, that's cute, man. Is your your son, is he interested in games right now?
He loves games.
Fortnite or
Fortnite, your Apex, you got your Roblox, you know, all the stuff that kids play.
I mean, it is fair to mention that in the scene you were, I'd say, one of the first players that was affiliated with a legit company. You know, you had a proper jersey with your name on, being affiliated with Mighty Ape. Could you tell us about what that relationship was like?
So in the beginning, when Street Fighter V dropped, like, I'd be the first one to put my hand up and be like, no, this game sucks, you know, just disregard it, I hate this game. And it just came from me personally. It wasn't a bandwagon thing. I just genuinely did not like the game. And just a random call from one of the guys at Mighty Ape. He goes, oh, you know, we're having this little LAN tournament. I think it was Ping Zero, I think it was called.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And they're just like, oh, do you want to sort of jump in with Mighty Ape, you know, Team Mighty Ape, and just play a bit of Street Fighter V? Like, at the time, I hadn't played in a long time. Like, I was super nervous. So I was like, I don't know how serious they were in regards to, like, wearing their jersey and their name and that sort of thing, but I took it quite seriously, and I was like, all right, I gotta practice or this sort of thing. And the tournament itself, I don't think I did very well, because that was the reign of Salt Factory, right?
Oh yeah.
So so I was like, oh damn, I think I gotta practice now. But it was actually news to me that the Mighty Ape was like, oh, we want to permanently put you on the team and sort of sponsor you. And I was like, whoa, like, really? Like, really? This is like one of my biggest dreams, you know? Like, a player's like a fighting game player's like, I'm gonna get sponsored? Like, really? I couldn't believe it. But yeah, it's definitely something I'll always remember and, you know, not take for granted. And I guess being involved with the team was a pleasure, man. Like, these guys are awesome.
Yeah.
The guy that managed me, Chad. Sorry, bro, I've forgotten your last name. But Chad. He was an awesome dude, man. Always looked after me and always made sure things were going right and just genuinely making sure I was all right. Yeah. You know?
Honestly, Mighty Ape are such a, like, I think they're such a good company. They stock some really good things, and you hardly hear any bad feedback about them.
No, yeah,
Do you have
yeah.
any, like, funny or crazy stories, like, while you were partnered up with them?
Yeah. Since I'm not partnered with them anymore, that freaking Mighty Ape stick, man. Jesus.
Oh, the gorilla one, right?
Yeah. Because when they first dropped it, they were like, oh, we want you to use this and sort of advocate for it and, you know, try and push it and use it during tournaments and all that. And in the beginning, I was like, yeah, sweet. You know, free fight stick. I can't complain about that. Yeah. And a lot of the NZFGC peeps picked up on the sort of the faults, you know. It'll just drop out and just totally cut out. And I was like, Everyone's like, was it? Did you test it or this sort of thing? And
they're like thinking, like, are you really supporting this, man? Like,
no, yeah. And I was like, they're like, oh, ask support. Don't ask me. You know, I'm just a player. Don't ask me.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it was hilarious. Man.
Jesus. Yeah, I think you were the only, like, I never really saw anyone with that gorilla type stick. One player, and they're not even from Auckland.
Like, from I think. From memory, there were two other people that used that stick. One being Soul Brother. You know, he hated that stick just as much as me. And there was also another player, Kirid. I can't remember what your GT was, bro. Sorry. But he was from Rotorua. He used, I think he still does, uses a Mighty Ape stick.
Oh.
Can't forget about Sketch. He still uses a Mighty Ape stick too.
Oh, wow.
Oh, all the way from Australia.
Yeah.
Or US.
All right. Well, be honest, man. Had you ever shopped with Mighty Ape prior to being sponsored with them?
Yeah.
Good. You know.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, we're definitely not going to support someone who's never bought anything from us. It's like, oh.
Yeah. So, I've done a lot of prior shopping, you know, buying games from them, mainly because, dude, their delivery was awesome.
Yeah.
It was almost always overnight. There was a time where I pre-ordered a game and I'd forgotten about it and, like, received it, like, immediately on the day. And that's the sort of service you want from someone.
Yeah.
That's the sort of thing that keeps you coming back.
What's the best thing you've ordered from Mighty Ape?
The best thing I've ordered... that I got for free or...?
Yeah, I suppose. If for free could count.
Oh, right. Yeah, most of the stuff that I did order from Mighty Ape was, you know, mostly games and new releases. But I did try out ordering some of their health supplements and all that sort of thing, you know, going to the gym and all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest thing I ever did get from them was probably this Mighty Ape seat that I'm on at the moment. And I'll probably never get rid of this. Hey, it's so comfy.
I just wish that there would be more job vacancies for Mighty Ape, man. It just seems like anytime I hear of one, it's been like weeks and it's already filled.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, well, in one of the previous clips, we saw the glasses that you were wearing, the Cyclops right. ones.
Yep.
And I know that in tournament, if you weren't wearing them, there'd be someone off to the side, probably Lennox, being like, "Wear the glasses." Can you actually explain what that thing is about?
Yeah, man. So the glasses, I think I started wearing them in 2018 from memory. I wore them basically the whole year. But the thing behind it was just, I don't know, I just wanted to do something different. You know, I've been involved with the NZFGC for a long time. I've been doing the same thing, being too serious sometimes, you know, for my liking. And I just wanted to just loosen up a little bit and maybe create another person, you know, persona,
yeah,
and to sort of play on it. And yeah, that's where it all really came from. But the glasses themselves, they're actually based on another dude called see, trying to think on my feet here, it's not easy.
Don't worry, I know who you're thinking about. William Wydaway.
Yeah, that's William Wydaway. Yeah, that's the one. Sorry.
No, you're right, man. So yeah, the Cyclops glasses, the Wairua, and there was even a little gesture he did with his finger or something.
Yeah, he did it with his whole hand. Yeah. It was called some kind of swiper. I don't know what it was, but I just kind of borrowed it off of me.
It's funny that you said you thought you were serious, because I never thought that at all. You just seem like another run-of-the-mill player, but I acknowledge the fact that you just wanted to add a bit of flair, I suppose, outside the game.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, I mean, obviously, okay, well, I guess I should mention this thing now. So you've got your Red Bull Kumite interview.
Right.
And this was such a great experience, not only for the fighting game community here, but for Street Fighter players, for it to really feel involved in a big, grand scheme of things.
Oh, right. It was amazing.
Yeah. The weeks building up to the Red Bull Kumite, like, where were you mentally?
I was just trying to, like, just play it out and just use this sort of that character, you know, that I was just previously talking about. And I was like, oh, I might just take it to another level, you know, might just cosplay. And because one of the guys I remember talking to during the Dragon Ball Z tournament, the one that LPL held.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was just like, bro, like, this is all like sort of showy sort of thing. Just ride that wave, bro. Ride that wave. Whatever you want to do, just do it. You know, just, you want to be a showman, be a showman, all that sort of thing. And I kind of took it on board and started playing on it a little bit more. And, you know, that's sort of where the old G cosplay came from. You know, that's where the inspiration was.
Yeah. So, like, what with cosplay, like, did it have to be, like, what am I trying to say? I guess what I'm trying to ask is, like, how did you view, like, when you viewed your cosplay, did you, like, how long did that take to prep the G look?
Oh, that took maybe, I don't know, about 10 minutes, to be honest. It didn't take that long. I was just trying to build it around the hat. Like, that try hat. Not to be too, yeah. It all just came from the hat.
Okay.
I was like, yeah, because some of the guys were like, oh, where's the gold paint and all that sort of thing. I was like, oh, that's a bit out of my reach, you know.
Yeah.
That's probably the level I would like to be at, but it might take a bit too much effort. So
just like, tailored to my level of capabilities.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. So, like, I was just casual.
If you could put a ballpark figure on your look for G, how much would you have said you spent?
Well, I already had the suit, I already had the vest, the pants, and the shoes. So the hat was like $5.
Oh, really? $5?
Yeah, that was it.
Shit, okay.
It was a $5 cosplay.
Yeah, and that shirt, I'm assuming, is old because you had to rip the sleeves off.
Yep, it was an old shirt. It was actually a shirt I bought from the islands, but it was just a cheapy one. So I was like, I'm not going to miss it. I never wear it.
Yeah,
well, it's just rubbish.
Yeah, hey, I give you credit that you did that, because, like, that was at Studio The Venue on Kate Road. Like, was it on a Saturday, or
I think it was a Saturday.
Yeah,
had to have been a Saturday.
This is Saturday early morning, Cave Road. You rocking up, looking like G. I was just thinking, props to you, man. I think I looked
at we're all waiting at the door to get.
Oh God, I looked at you and I thought, okay, all right, man, wasn't showing up, all right.
Yeah. Well, but in saying that, I was like, I'm a hitter player as well, but, you know, I'll have a bit of fun.
Yeah. Okay, so I should ask about the three players, Ghost Chips, Sky, and Zarsob. Now, this is on the day of Red Bull Kumite.
Mm-hmm.
What was your track record like with those three prior to the Red Bull Kumite? Like, did you go in thinking, like, these are three people I really need to watch out for?
Definitely. They were definitely at the top, but in saying that, quite a few of the other players there were, you know, definitely force to be reckoned with, man. We had some players from, you know, Wellington that I had only played once, and that, whoa, sorry, bro, can I check?
Yeah, you're all good.
But, I played a guy from Wellington, and, I had heard that he was a really good player, and I was like, yeah, it's sweet. So when I ran into him in that during that day, he gave me a scare and almost eliminated me. So,
man.
All three of those top players, Sky, Zarsob, and Ghost Chips, man, it was always going to be tough.
Yeah.
But, you know, I ended up running into Ghost Chips anyway and put up a decent fight. There were quite a few mistakes from what I remember playing him that cost me a couple of rounds, but on a good day, I think I could beat them.
Yeah,
definitely.
So after that match, we saw a bit of it in the intro. Did you happen to talk with any players afterwards? Because I would imagine that an experience like that, like just coming short, you know, did anyone kind of offer any like advice or support?
Oh yeah, there was a heartbreaker in that last round where what was I supposed to do? I think I was supposed to super offer confirm, but as G, if you don't enter the right buttons properly, you can actually you can what is called power up, presidential power up.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I did that accidentally instead of supering, and I ended up losing the whole round just for that.
Oh, man.
I was like, oh, wow, you know, it's a loss. You take it as it is.
Well, like, with Street Fighter V now, it's a real interesting time. You know, we're behind closed doors, but some of the pro players aren't heavy on the grind. You know, they're just kind of doing other things. I guess my question to you is, even if this was a quiet year without offlines, would that really hinder the legacy of Street Fighter V, considering the bumpy road it's had?
Nah, I doubt it. Mainly because this season of Street Fighter, I've heard a lot of good things about it. Everyone's enjoying it. Apparently, it's the most balanced version so far.
Yeah.
But you know, I can't really talk from my experience because I haven't been playing it that much. I've got to be honest. Because even during the Rambats, just in the weekend gone, the online Rambats, I hadn't played since Champion Edition dropped. So going back to my main characters, I was like, oh, shit, he can do that? I didn't know that. Oh, that's cool. But it's not going to be enough for me to come back. But I think Street Fighter, it'll be around for as long as they need it to be around. So. Yeah.
Well, you said you may not commit to offline anymore, but would you do the odd offline session, off online session now and then? Online session. Would you do the online session
online,
on and off again? Should have chose different words.
Yeah, no, I get you. Online's just easier. You know, like I can juggle that easy as, and just with offlines and stuff, it's just gotten a little bit more difficult nowadays.
Yeah.
That magical number of three kids, that did it. Like, there was no way I was recovering from that. But I can't say no to onlines. Definitely not. Because, you know, obviously, I still enjoy it.
Yeah. I guess just right now, the difficult with no offlines is that, well, it poses a challenge where how do you keep the community really active if it's solely online? And I think this is, Milky suggested this could be the opportunity where orgs can really be innovative with their content, just being experimentative. Right. And I like looking at the Genuine Gaming page. I'm not trying to plug Milky, but like they do some really good like random like gift, you know, like random competitions and like little gifts and stuff. Are there any organizations that you follow that you... Like, are there any orgs that you like following because of their content?
Because of their content, see, I'd probably say, to be honest, in that regard, I'm quite lazy when it comes to following stuff. I'm like keeping updated and with what organizations are doing. Where I tend to rely on just what the other community or what our community is talking about, you know, and just sort of stick to that.
Yeah.
So if there are like organizations talking about something that's so, you know, good or bad, like for instance that that thing that's been happening with the collusion or some what was that about? No, I can't remember anymore. But everyone was talking about it. This whole ESP new organization coming in to do, I think it wasn't Rocket League, was it?
Oh no, you mean the gambling thing, right?
Yeah.
Oh man. Yeah.
Yeah. So if it wasn't for the community actually talking about that, I would never know. You know.
Yeah. Well, actually, that could be a question I could ask you. Is what do you think of introducing gambling in esports for the future, like for various titles in the future?
Gambling in esports. Yeah. Like for me, in my own opinion, throughout my whole sort of career. I'll call it a career, you know, fighting game career. I never did one money match, not one, not a single match. Even when I went over to Australia,
you've never done one,
not one.
But have you ever been proposition?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Some of the old OG boys, you know, used to hit them up and they'll say, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not going to name names, just, you know, just to keep it safe. But, I'll be open about the other one. I was supposed to do one with Reap Your Face in Nationals last year. Oh, I was actually looking forward to that one. But
So you know, why didn't that happen, bro?
Bro, that, I think it wouldn't have happened anyway because of the whole debacle of the after party. But but Reap Your Face had something going on in the morning, and I was there in the morning, and I couldn't be there at night, and he was there at night, and it was like, oh, it was a mess. So we both ended up just be like, oh, we'll have to reschedule it. So that's sort of one of the things that might have to pull me back and play, you know. But yeah, it was dumb, but
yeah,
can't do anything about it.
So I always associate you as a Street Fighter V player, but I mean, I know you haven't been, as you haven't been really on the Street Fighter V grind recently.
Right.
But where do you stand with Dragon Ball FighterZ? Because that's another game that's just had a bit of a system change.
Yeah, yeah. So Dragon Ball FighterZ this season, it's gone through a massive change. You know, they've updated quite a few things, and that's actually made it a lot more fun. You know, people are just, it's quite active online, I'd say. It's quite easy to find games. But Dragon Ball FighterZ, some of the other guys that picked a strong following, you know, back in Garden of Might, I think it was its first tournament.
Yeah, yeah, it's very first.
Yeah, I think there was something like 40 to 50 players or something. It was huge anyway, you know. And I guess it's been going on a bit of a downward slope since then, you know, not as many players, and you're seeing the same dominant players throughout the tournaments and all that sort of thing. But this season's interesting because we're starting to see a lot of the younger players starting to come in and actually dominate and be really good. And it's really good for any game, really. But Dragon Ball FighterZ, that's probably what it might be looking for to sort of prop itself up and, you know, get more active and attract those numbers.
Yeah,
we'll see.
Actually, hopefully. I was meant to mention this before, but here's you playing Reno. And Shamir made this interesting comment about like Reno being on the come up, but I don't know. Some people are saying that he's kind of hitting that plateau, like he's starting to hit some of the big boys and stuff. Did you ever feel that pressure from him, like prior to your last tournament experience?
As in me hitting a plateau, or
him hitting a plateau? Because obviously we know who the big dogs are. And I'd definitely say you're one of them. But I would say Reno's kind of on the come up a little bit, eh?
Yeah, oh, yeah, definitely. He's definitely gone stronger. I've always sort of disliked, maybe? It might be just something related to playing other Nakali players.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's sort of figured out what he's been lacking and what he needs to improve on. And that's, I don't know if it's something else that someone has told him, but you know, he's kind of picked that up, and him being an open-minded player, it's really done wonders for his gameplay.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's definitely coming up, and I reckon he's got a lot more, you know, room for improvement. I've always told him when I first met him, you know, he's got, bro, you got a lot of potential. And I think that was Crush Counter 1, I first met Reno. So, that was a while ago.
Okay. And, yeah, now I'm going to say you. When do you feel like you hit the plateau?
Oh man, I hit the plateau ages ago.
who was it and how was the experience?
Okay, let's see. Definitely one of the top players. Trying to pinpoint it though, it's going to be hard. But if I had to say, you know, typically speaking, plateaued where I was like, what the hell do I do? How do I beat this dude? Sort of thing. It'll probably be Jamie, you know, Jamie Zaza. Finding that dude is a mission, you know. It's, you know, I probably couldn't speak for myself because, you know, everyone else has played him. He's quite talented fellow himself. And I found that trying to beat this dude was I can't play my normal way that I want to play. It just doesn't work.
Yeah.
So it's like, again, I'll bring that term up, bro. Been using organized chaos to beat people is it sort of carried me through some of my Street Fighter V days, you know.
Yeah. I mean, as you said, you know, he's a part of the Salt Factory. What is it about the Salt Factory that's so? Now, I'm not being disrespectful. I'm just saying, why are they so intrusive? Like, you, like there always seems to be like a trial for every member of that group.
I guess, well, I'll kind of speak on the term where what's made them good, in my opinion. It's they have this little focus group of really, really talented players that they can just bounce ideas off, or one person might be good at this and another person might be good at this, and when they put them all together, you know, they sort of improve and level up, I guess, quicker than everyone else can. And that's the beauty thing about the Salt Factory in general, you know. It's what I think, in my opinion, made them so strong. They were able to just play each other and, you know, get stronger that way. Because, you know, if you've got players to play offline, which is the best environment to practice, you're going to get better, you know? Like, it's not hard to figure out.
Well, who would you normally, practice with certain players, or do you just hit the lab, bro?
I guess it'd be 50-50. Most of my play was lab-based, you know, just practicing scenarios. But the other 50, you know, it was practicing with someone that I knew was maybe at my level or better. So if I took it back to like Street Fighter 4, that would obviously be Rumble, you know. Me and him would play a lot, you know, just bouncing back and forth and figuring out different things. And, you know, back then I always, you know, he was a good friend, but he was definitely my rival back in those days. And I guess coming into Street Fighter 5, it was a little bit harder because he had dropped off, and trying to find that person to sort of stick with and practice with was a little bit difficult.
Yeah,
obviously the online at the time was pretty kirker, but yeah.
Yeah,
it still is pretty dodgy, but
yeah.
Mm.
I mean, like, do you think they'll ever fix it in Street Fighter 5 time?
No way. It's gonna stay whatever it is till it dies, you know, or until, yeah, Street Fighter 6 comes out. I don't see it getting better. It never will. It hasn't by now, you know.
So, like, with all the tournament experience you've had and all the travel that you've done, like, in the country, could you pick one all-time good tournament you've entered?
In terms of results or just in general?
Anything. Could be results. It could just be just for the hell of it, or?
Oh, right. One that stands out for me would probably definitely be Garden of Might. That venue was awesome, man.
Yeah.
They had everything. That like venue was great. It ran great. We got lunch. Like that's never happened.
We got lunch. Ever. Bro, yeah, we got lunch.
We got lunch.
We got Dragon Balls. It's like, yeah.
Bro, it was awesome, man. Oh. They even had karaoke.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. Oh, that's right, because also that was the weekend that the final episode of Super came out, I think.
Like, yep.
That just made, and obviously Dragon Ball FighterZ being the first tournament for that game, that just made it so much more like, oh yeah, this is the Dragon Ball FighterZ tournament. Yeah, man.
Yeah, I think it had the intro of Goku turning Super Saiyan 3 for the first time.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah, just before Top 8.
Oh, yes, they did. That's right, yeah.
You know how long that is, eh?
Bro, that's like half an episode, eh?
Yeah, it was hilarious, man. Yeah, but man, I think at the time, probably the perfect way to start it. So, yeah, it was awesome.
So, I mean, like, the meta now, because before it was like the overbearing team was like, was it Kid Goku, Bardock, and Kid Goku, Bardock, and Kid Buu?
Like, yeah, something
was Broly, Kid Goku, and Bardock? I couldn't remember.
Yeah, last season, it was Bardock, GT Goku, well, anybody really, and Super Saiyan Goku. So if it was usually built around that shelf. So you were like Bardock and Super Saiyan Goku with anyone in the middle, but most of the time you'd see G2 Goku and everyone hated him, eh? Like,
yeah.
It was hilarious.
Yeah.
But like that particular Goku, like his playstyle reminded me a lot of Rolento from Street Fighter 4, which is why I was so fond with the character. Like, everyone hating on him was like, nah, he's fine, he's fine. he needs a bit of a nerf bat, but nah, he's fine.
Yeah.
Everyone hated him. It was great.
It was you and Tosh that was in that LPL Arcade Reborn qualifier for the grand final, and I loved how it ended with that dramatic finish, Goku and Kid Buu.
Oh god, yeah, I don't know if he thought about it, but when he did it, oh man, that was godlike. He was like, oh, it's just a setup, like it's a meaty setup, and it happened to kill you, and it got the dramatic finish. I was like, bro, fist bump, that was awesome.
A lot's happened since then, because like Tosh hadn't really been playing fighters consistently, neither was Blackout. I mean, he was kind of touching it, but he was playing other games. It's almost left this window, it's almost left this opening as to like there's no, like, if you had to call out a national champ, you would probably say it's out of Tosh or Blackout. But both of them aren't really heavy in the game as they were before. Like, could you say, if those two weren't in the picture, who would you say would be up for the title of New Zealand's Best for Dragon Ball Fighters?
New Zealand's Best? Currently, I would probably say Young Crazy Head, all the way down from Christchurch. Really young player. I think he's 17, 18. We'll go with 18.
Okay.
I'm not actually sure his age, but he's quite a young dude. And the first time I met him was at Southern Cross Up 20, might have been 2018. Was that at Ridges Hotel, 2018? Might have been 2017.
No, I think it was 2018. 2018 was Ridges, yeah.
Yeah. I met him there. I didn't know him at the time. And I had some casuals with him in fighters, and he absolutely bopped me. And I was like, what the hell? Like, hey, bro, where are you from? Sort of thing, you know?
Yeah. But
definitely out of him or another up-and-coming guy. You know, he came to last nationals, that being KO King.
Oh, yes.
Quite a young, he's a young dude as well. He actually plays Tekken really well too. I didn't know that, but yeah, because when I was running the Dragon Ball Fighters tournament, the bracket, he was holding our bracket up, like, we were waiting for this dude, and like, bro, where is he? It's like, he's playing Tekken, like, for the next, I guess, hour and a half, we were waiting for him to finish, because he was just bopping everyone, you know?
Yeah.
But, I would say, out of, Crazy Head and KO King, definitely up there for being one of the best.
And they've, they've already, like, I mean, all the characters that are for the recent season, do you think there's still more potential for Dragon Ball FighterZ?
Oh, yeah, I reckon there is. Because I mentioned it previously with this latest update where they've just covered a lot of things that people were complaining about, you know? It's not something I'm used to, being a Capcom player where the developers actually listen to you. But, Arc System, man, it's done really well with this game. You know, it's a beautiful game. I'm a big fan of the anime, obviously. But I think a lot of the people, there might be that intimidation factor with some of the usual godlike players, you know?
Yeah.
But it's actually a simple game to pick up. Yeah, you sort of get better as you play some of us or some of the guys that have been playing it since it came out. But it's got a lot of potential. It's just got to keep it alive.
I do remember Tosh telling me once that to learn this game, like, because there's so many, like, I guess the way you approach how to learn it, like, he did say it was easy, but just like, because there's so many, it offers various like paths of setups and like the windows to confirm. I don't know. It's just all crisscrossing across the screen. I can't deal with that, man.
Yeah, I know what you're saying, but it's like you can choose a certain playstyle and just stick with it. You know, I've played people online where their only confirmation, you know, the only way to combo is using auto combos, and you know, that's fine.
Yeah.
Some, I'm not going to say that too well, but you know, I've lost to a couple of them playing like that. But you can play it any way you want. It doesn't really matter, you know. But it's just really up to people showing an active interest in the game and liking the game for what it is and taking it seriously.
Who would you say gave you a hard time? Was it Tosha's Gohan or Blackout's Hit?
Oh, God. Definitely Tosha's Gohan. Oh, man. Like, for the anime, I was always a huge fan of Gohan, but Toshi, I dislike that character so much.
What was it about his Gohan? Because like he had that level, you know, that power up. Depending on the level, and then he had his like ultimate, which seemed to be a real strong ultimate.
Yeah. So the main thing that was very annoying to play Gohan play was the fact that you have to be careful when you're pressuring him because he had a DP. So when he's on defense, you've always got to be aware of that. And in this game, it's all about, you know, everyone wants to press buttons, lots of buttons, block strings. But if you didn't have proper block strings, you were getting blown up immediately by Gohan's DP. And, like, on the other side, if Gohan was, you know, he was the oppressor and being aggressive, he had this thing where he could fast fall. So, how do I explain that? It's sort of like, in this game, every character, they had to fall normally. You know, you jump, you come down.
Yeah.
But adult Gohan had this thing where he could jump and come down immediately, like just fast fall and drop. Mm-hmm. So he would use that in pressuring situations, and, you know, he can create mix-ups from that. So you're like, oh, yeah, it's high. And then he'll drop, and then, you know, he could do whatever he wanted. It was frustrating. So you're like, you're blocking low, blocking high, it didn't matter. You still got mixed. It was frustrating.
All right. So now we come to the last tournament, the last ride. So this is Southern Cross Up 2019. And a tournament that had a lot of stuff going on, not just for the weekend, but like afterwards, you know, with people like, yeah, a lot of stuff happened that weekend. Can you take us through your mental state and the progress in the brackets that you entered?
Okay, so I entered probably the most games I've ever entered at a major, not even talking about a nationals, you know, a nationals game. So I think I entered maybe nine games.
Wow.
Trying to think of how many main games I entered. I think it was four or five main games and four side games. Now, my aim for that tournament was, bro, have as much fun as you can, you know, enter as many games as you can and hope for the best, you know. Not to say that I didn't practice, you know, I definitely practiced, but yeah, that was pretty much my mindset, just have as much fun as you can. Whatever happens, happens. Yeah. You know?
So give us so just take us through the day. So like your Saturday, so you had you know, like Street Fighter, Dragon Ball.
Yep.
Were you mainly focused on Street Fighter, or did you just kind of, like you said, you just entered with like, oh, we're just going to go all in, have some fun?
Yeah, so I sort of did practice across all the games except Samusho. I don't even have the game, so I couldn't even practice. But, you know, the side games were easy enough. The side games were just fun, and most of them were on emulators anyway. So I guess I did practice for Street Fighter V. I practiced just my main characters, you know, Urien and G. And I happened to have Zazob in my bracket, so that kind of made me roll my eyes. I ended up losing to Zazob, you know, quite quickly. And I was like, yeah, it is what it is. And I think my next opponent was, it was freaking Kuki. Kuki was my next opponent, so I was like, oh my god, I've got to play Kuki.
He's another one that is, when I watch him, he's starting to get like, he's actually scary like to face against, eh?
Yeah. He's crazy. I've been playing Mike for years, you know, ever since Street Fighter 4, Street Fighter 4 era, and he's still got the same play style. From like 10 years ago, he still plays the same way. high risk, all that sort of thing, high risk, high damage. But, you know, I'm just going to say this quietly, with his character, you know, he sort of mitigates that high risk, you know.
Yeah.
Bison has no high risks. He just has high reward all the time. It's so annoying. But, yeah, he ended up beating me real quick, and I was so salty. That was the first time I've ever gone 2-0 in a Street Fighter game.
Ever? Oh, wow. Man.
Yeah, 0-2. I'm sure I went 0-2 in Street Fighter 5.
Okay, that, yeah. So Street Fighter, you're out.
Yeah.
Dragon Ball FighterZ, any of the Marvel games?
Jesus, did I play Marvel Infinite? Yes, I did. I definitely did. Because I ran into Tufts, and me and Tufts, he likes to have this sort of a rivalry between us and Marvel. And yeah, I kind of accepted it, you know. I was like, no, I don't really play, but, you know,
yeah.
I'll bop you. I'm an OG, bro. I'm a bop you anyway, sort of thing. And I ended up beating him. He was not happy about that, but yeah. I was like, yeah, you know, I know him quite well, and I just rub it in his face. Yeah, scrub, get out of here.
Yeah,
but yeah, Marvel was pretty fun. But I knew from the get go that I wasn't going to get very far. And Dave ended up beating me. He knocked me out. It was actually a closer game than I thought it was going to be. But yeah, he ended up taking me out again. I always run into Dave and Marvel, and he beats me. I almost beat him at, I think, was Crush Counter 2, 3. How many has there been? Three.
I think there's been three.
Oh, there's been three. Yeah, so Crush Counter 3. I almost beat him. I can't remember the reason. Some dropped input, but never mind. Lost to Dave again.
Yeah. So it's
all good.
Dragon Ball FighterZ, Sam Show, and then once you're...
Yep. Sorry, I'll talk about Sam Show for a little bit. Sam Show is an awesome game, man. Like, I used to play it when I was like tiny, wasn't, you know? I remember it being fun. I remember Hoamaru and throwing that tornado and all that sort of thing. And the first time I touched Sam Show was at a Rambats. Jay, one of the guys, he was playing it and goes, bro, was it? You play this game? I was like, oh, you know, way back. He's like, bro, I'm going to show you the ropes. I was like, sweet. And I ended up coming second, I think it was, at that Rambat. You know, it was the first Rambats Sam Show, and it ended up being a fun game.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it wasn't enough for me to buy it, but, you know, it was a good game. And then Nationals, still didn't have the game. I hadn't practiced at all. I didn't know what I was doing. And quite funny, I ended up being Reno, which everyone knows, you know, Shanae's partner. Obviously, he may have practiced or labbed some stuff. And we had a mirror match with Tam Tam, and I ended up beating him, which was freaking hilarious. I even told him it was hilarious. It was funny. He didn't like that, but, you know, no one likes being told they practice and being beaten by someone that's never played it.
Yeah, man.
that's another story, you know. But, yeah, it was fun.
So now we get to this period where you're out of all the tournament, you know, you're out of all the games.
Mm.
So this feeling of, you know, this is my last event, like, did the thoughts and feelings come as soon as you were eliminated from all games, or was this after the weekend?
Probably after the hangover wore off, I'd say. Because I think the top 8 game I made was Mortal Kombat. I made top 8 for that. And dude, I was death, right? But I was like, I still had no regrets, you know. And after everything had played out and I finished my games and all that sort of thing, I kind of felt, oh, finally, you know, it's over. It's been way too long, and I sort of accepted the fact that, you know, my competitive career is over. It's all good. I had fun. Was it. It was cool. I was cool with it. So.
I just, you know, I know, I'm sure there's a few people, and I'm one too, just wish you would have said something, or you would have been like, hey, you know, you might want to come to this Nationals, you know, because I might not be seeing you for a while.
Yeah, I didn't drop a hint
or anything?
I actually did. I did drop something back when I was streaming. I was playing Sekiro, it was my last episode for that game because I finished it. And I told everyone that was watching, you know, this there's this big nationals tournament, fighting game tournament coming up, and it's potentially most likely going to be my last tournament. And I think at the time, only three people knew that this was going to be my last one, that being Shimeo, D Silva, and Soul Brother, or Too Rare to Bloody Long Name, you know, Too Rare to Live, Too Rare to Die.
Yeah.
Those were the only three people that knew that I was quitting. So, yeah, I didn't think it was that big a deal, you know? Like, I think it just comes with my personality. It's like, whatever, you know?
Yeah. Like, I'm here, I've done my bit, now it's time for me to go.
Yeah, I've done my bit, I'm going to have some fun, let's go drink, you know? That's all it was.
That's cool. Well, I mean, I still remember seeing the tweets saying, like, you know, you better be coming to an after party for the first, you know, major next year and stuff. Like, you are coming though, right? And you're like, yeah, I might be.
Was it doesn't miss a party, that's for sure.
But, well, I mean, you know, that happens and, you know, a couple of months go by and you just did, like an auto finish course, something to do with painting.
Yeah. So it's something I picked up quite late, you know, being in my 30s, whatnot, but it's a auto finishing automobile, you know, car finishing, you know, painting cars. So that's something I picked up and actually quite enjoy and picked up as a passion, you know, and I love it. So I'll probably stick around.
Do you like cars in general? Would you consider yourself a petrol head or a car junkie?
Probably a petrol head, to be honest. I've been into cars for a long time. Not a long time, I guess. Maybe since I was around a teenager, you know, 18, something like that. That's when I started picking up cars. So
what's the process that goes into painting a car full body? So, like, how long would, like, your average car take to paint? Like, literally front to back.
I'll shorten it down to as much as I can. So usually we don't do a full car. It's usually, so smash repair. It might be this corner, that corner, the front, or the whole front. So I think in general, if we were doing a whole, how long would that? Probably about 3 days, because you've got your team where they smash it up and get it straight and all that sort of thing. So, and once that's done, it comes to us and we take out any sort of minute details, like small defects that are along the panel. If it's not straight, we sort of fix it up.
Yeah.
And then after that, it shoots into the oven and we spray it up, paint it up, and the guys put it back together and it goes out. So, yeah, the process is quite simple, but, you know, it can get quite long and tedious sometimes, depending on the customer. Yeah, that's basically it.
But in terms of your workload, does it take much people to paint these specific parts?
So in terms of painting, usually one person's allocated to it. So if I'm going to do a job, that's what's usually called, you know, they'll be allocated one person to paint it, and it just rotates. So we've got three painters. Me being one of them, it'll just be me, next person, next person, me, next person, next person. It's, you know, it's, we just struggle to go around that way.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Okay. Sweet. Okay. Well, I guess I'll be getting to the last questions, man. So here is a selection of PS5 controllers, or they're called the DualSense. Yeah. Have you heard much about the PlayStation 5?
I've only seen the initial release, that white one, but other than that, no.
Okay. Well, here's some controllers. Some have been designed by other people, just custom designs.
Right.
So choose a controller for each child you have.
Ooh. Can I make this bigger? Probably not, eh? Full screen?
I'll try screen that.
Nah.
There you go. Hopefully that'll help.
Oh, that's a little bit better, yeah. So we're choosing a controller for each child, is it?
Yep.
There's one of them now. Not sure about that yellow one, eh?
Yeah.
What is that? That looks like a bumblebee-styled controller. But I'll probably go the red one for my oldest son. That's red, right? Red and blue?
Number 6. It's got a Spider-Man emblem, yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely. There you go. Yeah, that'll be my oldest son's. And what I can see is probably two pink ones. One looks like hot pink.
Yeah, number 10, the pink one.
Yeah, number 10 and the one next to it on the left.
Oh, probably. Nice. Very nice.
Yeah.
Okay. What have we got here? So, how would you like to be remembered by the NZFGC?
I guess just being the all around nice dude, you know, like being known for my gameplay and stuff is cool and all, you know, it's real cool. But the one thing that I've always tried to get across is like, don't take things so seriously, you know, there's always room to be, you know, or not to be, but to have fun in, you know, any sort of situation. And that's what I've kind of lived by throughout my fun game career, you know, just have fun, man.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, bro. Okay, well, if you didn't have the Cyclops glasses as a persona thing, what would you have instead? What would you have instead?
Honestly, I wanted to wear a gorilla mask, but I didn't want to get caught a freaking furry.
Oh, yeah, actually, good call. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I was like, oh, man, like, the disadvantages of wearing a mask would be really hot. Don't want to be called a furry. That was it.
Yeah.
So I was like, glasses it is.
A good thing, though, is you can trash talk and not like people can really tell if it's, you know, full mask.
Yeah. But it goes the same way with the glasses, you know, like you can feel yourself behind these glasses and be like, oh, it's fine, you know, I'll run my mouth. It's all good. Got glasses on. I'm sort of semi-protected.
Yeah, bro. Would you choose a new season of Street Fighter V or you bring on Street Fighter VI?
Maybe if you asked me this in like the beginning seasons, maybe season 1, 2, possibly 3. At the moment, nah, I think it's got at least another year or two before it sort of dies out. You know, there's still characters that people want.
Yeah.
Me included. But I guess it's just a waiting game. Just gonna have to wait and see what they do. But I'll still be watching it from the spectator bench. Yeah, see what happens.
What's the best pop off you've seen at one of our fighting game events? I'm kind of asking you to bump someone in, aren't I?
No. I say that because there's been so many, and trying to pinpoint one's going to be really difficult. I want to say Dave, but then again, it was done so long ago that like I can't remember like every detail, because it was all to do with a money match. I can't remember if it was a grudge match or not, but there was a lot of money on the line. And I remember Dave just popping off. It was crazy, man. Like, it was a lot of fun because it was a close game.
Yeah. I guess imagining Dave popping off is something like most of us could never visualize, you know?
No. You would never see that happen nowadays because, you know, him being basically the godfather of the community, he's always in the back, you know, sort of giving orders and whatnot. So you'll never see him do that. But unless someone actually said, Dave, I want a money match, he will never turn down a money match.
Yeah. So
that would be the only way I could see him playing again.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Well, I guess we'll take that then. If Urien was a car, what would he be?
If Urien was a car? Ooh. I like that question. If Urien was a car? He would probably be... There's so many. Yeah, because Urien's quite the big head fellow. You know, he's the best, all that sort of jazz. So he'd probably be, I'd pick a Lamborghini. He'd be a Lamborghini Murcielago.
Nice.
Very loud, very big, very, it's everything that he is, you know. but not a yellow one. Probably something like a dark purple metallic, something like that.
Yeah, oh, yeah. No, I can see that. Nice. Who in the scene has the best sportsmanship?
Who has the best sportsmanship? Nobody. No. The best sportsmanship. Oh, I guess everyone in general was quite laid back. Hey, and that was one of the things that was talked about quite a while ago, where our community is so tight-knit that rivalries and stuff is quite hard to come by.
Yeah.
And that sportsmanship was always there. And who was the most sportsman like? How about the least?
Yeah, sure, the least.
No, I'm just being cheeky. But it's the most sportsman like. Well, it's hard to pick, eh? I'd probably pick myself. I'm quite sportsmanlike, I guess.
Yeah, no, that's an answer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who is your waifu, Wazza?
What? Ooh. Who are we talking?
Whoever you want, man.
Oh, I'd have to pick Final Fantasy X, Lulu.
Okay.
You know who that is?
Yeah. Okay, I'm just surprised.
What?
I'm just surprised it's a Final Fantasy pick.
Yeah, I picked Final Fantasy because that particular Final Fantasy, like it's it's got its problems, but the one thing I do remember was having Lulu on my team all the time because she had the those things. Yeah, they were always in your face.
Yeah,
and just the way she dressed was so out of it, man.
Oh yeah.
yeah, she comes to mind, definitely. Okay.
Well, just because it's you, the waifu isn't the last thing. The last thing is this one.
Oh,
describe your entire NZFGC journey in one sentence.
One sentence? Ooh, okay.
Not a word. It can just be like a proper sentence, you know.
A proper sentence. Yeah. Oh, okay. All right, give me a few seconds. Okay. We got smack talking, drunk, family man. That's it.
That's cool, man. I like that.
That's the best I could come up with.
No, it's good. It's short. It's got impact.
To the point.
Yeah, to the point. I just want to thank you again for coming on. And like I said to you before, there were quite a few people wanting you to have an episode, you know, because you deserve one, man. And you've been a long time player, long time presence.
Thank you.
No, you're welcome. Is there any last words or shout-outs you'd like to make?
All right. Shout-out to the NZFGC crew, of course. Without them, I wouldn't even have a name for myself. You know, I wouldn't be playing these games. Also, shout-out to all the organizations that are supporting them. Shout-out to yourself, too, bro, you know, for what you do. And everyone else for what they do. The Twitter universe, everything, man. So shout-out to Dave themselves and all those guys, man. Like, I love you guys, man. Take care of yourselves. Peace.
Take care, guys.